Well, I propose this talk because I thought it might be a good idea to explain to you how the ideas and the proofs came to prove that Galois is large. Galois is large, in fact, in my lecture, that must be essentially the case of an elliptic curve over a number field with no complex multiplication. I think the game started essentially by a letter of Tate, July 1962, some time ago, in which Tate was investigating the following question, in general for abelian varieties. You have an abelian variety A over a number field K. You're interested in the group of rational points. And that's a group which is some z to the power something plus finite group, the Mordel-Weil group. And you look at the following. On this group, there are two natural topologies. First one is the subgroup of finite index. Well, I mean, a neighborhood of zero being a subgroup of finite index. The completion with respect to that is a profinite group attached to the group. The second one is the following. You look at A of K goes to the product A of KV, where the V are the places, finite places, not the Archimedean ones. So this is in a natural way a compact profinite group. And that gives you a topology on A of K. And the question that Tate and Cassels wanted to solve, was the following. Are they the same? So in concrete words, if you give yourself a subgroup of finite index of the Mordel-Weil group, can you find congruence conditions locally which imply that the element is there? And I tell you already, the end of the story will be, the answer will be yes. But that will wait until, about 10 years more about. But what Tate had done was to attack it by looking at some cohomology. And the cohomology is essentially the following. You choose a prime L, and you look at the Tate module, of course, TL, of the abelian variety. Now you have an action of the Galois group GK acts on that. And you get in this way a map, a continuous map from GK to the automorphisms, the linear automorphism, out of TL, which is a group which is, let's say, GL to N of ZL, where N is the dimension of the abelian variety. And you give a name to the image. The image is the thing which interests us. So let's call GL. Well, in other cases, one would call it GL infinity, but let's call it GL here, GL equals image of Galois, that is GK, in GL of TL. And of course, there is an action of GL on TL and also on the vector space. That's more convenient to work with that, QL tensor TL. And Tate proved that if one can show that the H1 of GL of VL is zero, this implies the yes answer, the equality, the congruence equality one wanted between topologies. He proved more than that, in fact. One has to say a little bit what this means. It's not entirely clear, because there is the topology on GL, topology on VL, so it's not a discrete Galois cohomology. But you can view it in the following way. You can say that by definition, you could say it's obtained by continuous cochains. That makes sense. But the way it comes into play is not that. It is, you take the projective limit of the H1 of GL in TL over the LM TL. These are finite, it's perfectly good cohomology. And that is the ZL module, you tensor it by QL. It's an exercise to prove that the two things are the same. But you have to be careful, they are the same, because GL is topologically finitely generated. That would be a trap for arbitrary Galois group. These things are delicate. Okay, so Tate did that, and he said, that means that we have to look at the structure of GL, the Galois group here. And he had done by hand the case where you have complex multiplication for an AP curve. So he wrote to me to ask, to explain. So that was the way I started on this type of question. Now there was a lucky accident is that I've always been interested in Lie groups. And I remember that the theory of Lie groups worked not only over the traditional fields R or C, but they also work over QL. And I think Lie groups exist. Not only that, but there is a theorem of Elie Cartan which says that over R, a closed subgroup of a Lie group is a Lie group. And that theorem works over QL. It's not true over C, of course, but it works over QL. So I realized immediately that GL is an L-adic Lie group. Because it is contained in a Lie group. This is a Lie group. It is an open subgroup in some GL. And also that the cohomology which comes here, H1 of GLVL, embeds into the cohomology of the Lie algebra, so let's try to write a German letter, GL. Uh, And it's not very different. I mean, if you enlarge slightly the number fields, they become equal. So they are practically the same. So the problem then was the cohomology of this Lie algebra. I looked essentially at the case of an elliptic curve first. And then for an elliptic curve, GL is a sub-Lie algebra of Lie of GL2. And the problem was enormously simplified because if you think of the possible description of all the subgroups, even of GL2, closed subgroup of that, not so easy. I mean, nobody wrote it, for instance, as far as I know. It's probably possible, but it would be a big mess. But if you think of the Lie algebra of that, it's a four-dimensional Lie algebra, which has a very simple structure. This Lie algebra is a one-dimensional Lie algebra due to the determinant, and then the Lie algebra of SL2. And by using the Frobenius, one sees this piece, the GL maps onto that. So the real problem is what is there. And in SL2, you don't have much choice. I mean, you have the full thing. You have a Borel subalgebra. You have a Cartan subalgebra. But you have a very short list. And you don't really have to determine them. All you have to do is to look at the cohomology and see in which case it is zero. So in that way, I made the proof very, very simply. So then one finds the theorem that for elliptic curves, H1 OGL VL is zero, and that solves Tate problem in that case. Let's see. Comment on fait? C'est le bouton. Il accepte de descendre. Ah non, il n'accepte pas. But at the time, I had no idea how to determine GL. The obvious guess was that if E has no complex, no CM, that implies GL is Lie GL2, or equivalently, Galois is large, that is, my GL is open in OT. But that will have to wait for not so many years. No, I think I proved that around 66. But I will explain the ideas of that. But I want to finish up with the question of the two topologies being the same and explain to you how it came out to be true. The fact is that much later, around 70, I realized that there was a simple criterion for some cohomology of a Lie algebra to be zero. The criterion is the following. Suppose you have a Lie algebra G sitting inside the endomorphisms of a vector space V having a characteristic zero. And suppose there exists one element, is enough, one element, an element, CX, in G, which has eigenvalues which are independent in a rather amusing sense with eigenvalues. You cannot, no relation of the shape, or for some n, sum of lambda 1, well, no need to write a sum, let's say, so such that lambda 1 plus lambda n plus 1, not for all lambdas and mu's in S. That is, you refuse that you have a slightly longer, larger number of eigenvalues equal to some like that. And then that implies, it's a nice exercise, hi of G and V equals 0 for I smaller than N. If N is 0, what does that mean? That means no lambda should be 0. In that case, H0 is 0, no fixed point, because the element X has no fixed point already. So you see, start with something very trivial, but the next case is less obvious, and that's the case I needed. And now, how do you get such an X? Well, that's very simple too. In our case, GL is the Lie algebra of GL. In GL, we have Frobenius elements. And for each Frobenius comes with its eigenvalues. But we are working in the Lie algebra, so we take the log. So the lambdas, in that case, are the log of the Frobenius. But they cannot satisfy such an equation, because if such a sum is equal to that sum, the product of the eigenvalues will be the product of the eigenvalues times root of unity. But by Weyl, the Archimedean bound don't fit. That's the proof. Okay, so that's the way the thing was solved. Later, Deligne told me that I should have done it in a different way. That is, the Lie algebra contains the smallest, of course, Lie algebra containing X. As an algebraic Lie algebra, one has to know something, that it's algebraic. And then you find that the algebraic envelope, the smallest algebraic Lie algebra containing G, contains the homotheses. And that will be a recurrent question in this game also. And now when you have the homotheses, you write some spectral sequence and the triviality is clear. Another way I want to see it, why should it be true a priori? Well, because if not, you would get some X. You would get a non-trivial X between V and the scalars. And if you think of the philosophy of the weights, there should not be an X between those things. So, but of course, you cannot make it a proof, or at least we could not make it a proof at the time. Okay, so now the next very tempting question was how to prove for an empty curve that Galois is indeed large, that is, that I get GL2. So what are the ideas behind that? But for a fixed L. As you know, such games are divided in two, essentially two pieces, working for a fixed L, and then after that, varying the L and trying to get an adelic result. But the first step is to fix L. Well, you have an empty curve without Cn. And you would like to prove that this GL is indeed the Lie algebra of GL2. Now, if not Lie GL2, what can it be? That's not difficult to answer because of the Frobenius elements we get. So there are essentially three possibilities. This GL could be a Cartan Lie algebra commutative of dimension 2, commutative case. It could be a Borel subalgebra and it could be what we want and what we should prove, that is a full thing. Lie GL2. So you have to eliminate the first possibilities, the two first possibilities. In fact, the first one cuts itself in two pieces because a Cartan Lie algebra can be either split. In that case, that means you can put it in the form, in a Borel, or non-split. It is a Lie algebra of a quadratic extension of QL. More precisely, the homothesis into quadratic extensions of QL. Now, one of the main thing is the theorem, that the Borel case and the split Cartan case cannot occur. Borel and does not occur, and split Cartan does not occur. Proof, idea of proof. Well, if you have a Borel, that means you have a line. You have in the space TL, you have a subspace of dimension 1, well, a ZL, direct factor, which is stable under Galois. Now you use it by making TL plus LM T1L. Now let's see, is that what I want to do? I guess, no, that's stupid. That's the opposite. T1L plus LM TL. You want to do that because that is also stable. And stable under Galois gives you an elliptic curve because you just divide. You take the elliptic curve whose Tate module is that. So you get in this way an infinite number of elliptic curves which are isogenous to E. And using the fact that there are no endomorphism, essentially, you show that they're distinct. That was nice because in 62, same 62, at the International Congress, Shafarevich had told us that there are only a finite number of elliptic curves over a number of fields isogenous to a given one. Finiteness. And that in turn was not so difficult to prove. It was and still is a consequence of Ziegel's theorem on integral points. Follows from solutions, integer solutions or S-integer solutions of equation of the type y squared minus x cubed equals d, something like that. So using that, this would contradict Shafarevich's theorem, which of course is forbidden, and so that case doesn't exist, and this one even more because it is contained in the Borel. So that's solved. That, and it solves that. It remains a case where you get a non-split Cartan. It's amusing to see that we still have the same, 50 years later, same problems with non-split Cartan. So how did we get rid of that? Now that cost a lot of effort, because the idea is the following. You start with a case where GL is a non-split Cartan. By extending scalars, a finite extension of scalars, one manages that the, oh sorry, I meant Lie of GL. You can reduce to the case where GL itself is contained in the Cartan. In particular, it's commutative. Well, then Taniyama had given some ideas around 57. He had given some ideas how to understand Galois representations which are commutative and which are Frobenius with reasonable properties. And Tate also a few years before, I developed his theory of Hodge type, that's where he introduced the famous CP, that is, you take QP, well, I'm switching to P by tradition, you take the algebraic closure and then you complete it, a rather funny construction. But he got so many nice properties of this thing that one can make up a systematic theory. Well, so okay, we can make a theory of abelian representations, abelian Galois representations. It was a long story, but I wrote a little book on that in lectures in 66, McGill. And one consequence of that is the following, that if you have a system of Galois representations with Frobenius and so on, I mean, I don't want to give all the details, of the type we know here. And if for one L it is abelian, the group is commutative, then this happens for every L. And moreover, you get a description of them. And in particular, in the case of elliptic curves, but this is true for abelian varieties too, but for elliptic curves, you find the following, that when you do that, you find that for half the L's, half in sense of density, the GL is of split Cartan type, and for the other half, it is of non-split Cartan. That is, you have obtained exactly the description that we know for complex multiplication, where it depends on whether the L splits in the quadratic field or not. But that is, we get half of the of Cartan, but that's forbidden. We have already shown that the split Cartan cannot occur, so that case does not occur. So that was a way to kill the. And so, at that point, we have the fact that for every L, we have a large Cartan subgroup. Incidentally, there is a kind of moral in this game, which is that if you want to prove something does not happen, you have to study it carefully. That is, you, I guess, in war, people would say that if you want to kill your enemy, you have to know your enemy first. So here I had to develop a theory of abelian extension for a case where I didn't want abelian extension, but I wanted to get rid of them. And, next step. Will be to prove that Galois is really large in the adelic sense. Galois large, adelically, for elliptic curves, meaning that if you take the image now GK in my Galois group, but then I map it into the product for every L of the odd TL, the theorem is that the image is open. Which implies some finite index, of course. That's equivalent because the image is closed, so finite index. The date for that, I think I found that around 70, and it was published in 72, but I want to explain the ideas also. Now, it's good to begin by corollaries, because especially those corollaries are still interesting at the moment, which is to look at TL mod LTL. Because then the odd of that is nothing more than GL2 over the finite field FL. And so a corollary of that theorem is that the map from GK to this is onto for all L but a finite number. So the division points, the Galois group of division points, are as large as they can be, at least for almost all L. Of course, as you know, in the lectures which will follow, the finite number will be discussed. I mean, the finite number is a difficult question, but let's try to understand that first. Now, an important remark is that that simple looking fact that you find GL2FL for almost every L but a finite number, that is essentially equivalent to the theorem. Conversely, that corollary, the corollary implies the theorem. That is, you don't have to care about what happens modulo L cube and so on. And that is thanks to a little group theory, I will tell you just the typical fact which is behind. Typical fact is the following. You look at SL2, because in such questions, the determinant doesn't give you any problem at all. You have a perfectly good control of the determinant. So you can pretend you're working with SL2. You have that map, which is well known to be onto. And the fact is that if you have a subgroup gamma, closed, of course, which maps onto that, so if gamma goes to onto SL2 FL, then gamma equals SL2 FL if L larger than 3. And that's an exercise in group theory, but it shows to you how better groups behave when they're non-abelian, when they're far from being abelian. You have that. And when L equals 2, you need to replace mod 2, replaced by mod 8. And you can guess that when L equals 3, mod 3 should be replaced by mod 9. Okay, if you use that, and also you have to use the fact that those things are essentially simple, well, they're not exactly simple, but almost. They are a two-sheeted covering of a simple group, and those simple groups are different. And that helps because when you vary L, they cannot mix. So you receive a lot from group theory at that point. If not, you get in real trouble. So the real question was to prove that. Then one tries to use the same philosophy as for the Eladic one. That is, try to see what are the enemies you're fighting with, and you have to study them. And in that case, it's very similar, really. The real problem, so one has to show that you cannot have an abelian image. Well, for instance, if you have a Borel image, then you can, for infinitely many L, then you can use exactly the same trick as before, because Shafarevich's theorem would also tell you it's impossible. You would get too many. So it's really abelian. But then, following the same idea, you have to show that if it is abelian for infinitely many else, because you cannot refuse one or two being abelian. L, that implies all of them, and in fact, contradiction. And here also, you have to study the case you fight with, and the idea is in looking at the inertia. The inertia subgroups at the primes of K dividing L. And more precisely, the inertia, as you know, has two forms. There is the so-called tame inertia and the wild inertia. The tame has order prime to L, this one has order power of L. And it is the tame one which is important. The tame inertia gives you homomorphism like the following. Let's call, well, let's assume, for instance, the residue field of, how do I call the residue field? K of V. K of V star, you're going to find by the time inertia, K of V star goes into GL2 of FL. And K of V being of characteristic L, you're working in the same characteristic. Then the decisive fact is that this can be obtained the following way. See, that's a group. It's a cyclic group of order prime to L. You're representing it in characteristic L. You can put it in diagonal form by extending scalars. And in the diagonal form, what shape can it have? It can have, well, the fact is, it has a following shape that the characters, so to speak, extracted from it are of the form lambda goes to a product sigma lambda to the power n sigma, where sigma runs through the embeddings of K of V into FL bar, and the n sigmas are numbers, and the fact is that n sigma are 0 or 1. So a priori, you could have any kind of n sigmas, but no, if they come from an elliptic curve, they are 0 or 1. How do you prove that? Well, it's a local problem. You have to look at an elliptic curve over a local field. You can remove a finite number of L's, so you have good reduction. So you make a model and you look. The same is true for abelian varieties, but that is less easy. But I asked at the time Renaud to prove it, because I was sure he would find a proof. And Renaud proved it by looking at properties of group schemes, of finite group schemes. So when you know that, you're in good shape, because you get this collection of the n sigmas, and they're not large. And if you have this situation for infinitely many L, then it's not too hard to go back to the description of abelian extensions and show that then there is a global abelian extension which gives everywhere what we want. And so everywhere we get something abelian, and then after that it's very easy. There is no problem. Oh, that was the main theorem for elliptic curves. And I published it in 72, so published. Okay, now we can continue in several different directions. Well, essentially there are two directions. First direction is for an elliptic curve, make it more precise. Because the theorem allows a finite number of exceptions, so we want to see what the exception could be. And the second thing is can we do something for abelian varieties? Well, since I don't have much time, I think. Well, what do you prefer I discuss? Okay, let me say a little something about abelian varieties, because after all, you're going to have several lectures on that. So in ambient varieties, at the moment, situation is not so good, but one has this following theorem. Assume A has no complex multiplication, as people say, no endomorphism. That is, and K bar A is E. And make some more assumption, like, for instance, assume dimension of A at least 3, for instance. Then Galois is large in the sense, then the corresponding Galois group is large as in the elliptic case, that is open. I mean at most 3. Yes. It is très well, one has a candidate, and not sure one has an explicit candidate in dimension 4, why it doesn't work. I can also prove it in dimension, in odd dimension. And some people have claimed that they can prove it in more cases, but I'm not sure. Okay. Is it open in the group? What is the natural group? You take the symplectic group of dimensions A to N. N is dimension of A. And you take the similitudes, symplectic similitudes, adelic. That is the product of the ZL. Now, what are the ideas? The ideas are very close to the previous case, but one essential thing which one has to use are Faulting's results dating from, I think, 1984. Because they give you the semi-simplicity of the Galois representation. And I had to prove that for elliptic curves in the hard way, but by Shafarevich theorem. And Faulting's essentially had extended Shafarevich theorem. So that's a rather natural thing. So Faulting gives semi-simplicity. Also the Tate conjecture. After that, you still have to work from a Galois point of view. And there are essentially two things which come into play. One of them is what I call the Frobenius tori. That is the fact that the Frobenius element in the group gives you much more than just one element. It gives you a full algebraic subgroup which you can describe and which is over Q, independent of L. So that's not difficult to show. And the second thing is a technique which I learned from Nori to study subgroups of GN, FL, when L is large with respect to N. So that's certainly, well, I have still 1 minute, but let me just say that how do you make subgroups of that? You have to realize who are the people who are going to play a role. So first, you have some isolated groups, so to speak. You have, let's say, the monster group, for instance. You can put it into some GLQ, reduce it mod L, you get something. But it has a fixed, so to speak, order. When L varies, it will be very small, so to speak. You will be able to prove it doesn't occur. So exceptional finite. You have commutative subgroups. They are disagreeable because there are plenty of them, of course. If you think of a carton and everything which is inside that, I mean, Okay. And you have groups of the type G of FL, where G is an algebraic group in GLN, for the symplectic group and so on. So essentially, you have those types. So Nori gives you a way to show that there is nothing more, gives you a way to construct this very beautiful construction of G. And after that, how can you win? Well, you win by showing first, no, the exceptional are not going to occur for L large. Commutative subgroups, if the thing were completely commutative, then you have this commutative theory, and you have class field theory. You really have your hands on something. Then if you have G of FL, you can expect to be able to prove that G is the group you really want. That is, that it is, in that case, the symplectic group, by looking at the list of groups. Because we have the list theory which gives us information. Okay, I think I've finished my time. C'était exactement ce dont je voulais parler quand je vous ai dit que je n'étais pas très sûr de ce qui était démontré ou pas démontré. Il y a en effet des travaux de Larsen et Pink. Et comme on dit, je ne sais pas quel travail il faudrait pour compléter les démonstrations. Oui. Telles qu'elles sont écrites, il y a eu un passage de trois lignes. Qui n'a pas de sens tel qu'il est. Et j'ai demandé à Reynaud de le démontrer. Reynaud m'a sorti une démonstration de deux pages de Reynaud pour être quelque chose de technique. C'est vraiment sérieux, mais c'était correct. Mais tel que c'était écrit, c'était impossible à voir. Donc, je ne sais pas.
Est-ce qu'il y a d'autres questions ou commentaires ?
Je voulais faire un petit commentaire sur ces questions de groupe de congruence, parce que je voulais... Je vais citer ça pour les variétés abéliennes. Et je voulais vous signaler que pour le groupe multiplicatif, on a le même énoncé qui est dû à Chevalet. Quand vous prenez le groupe des unités d'un corps de nombre, tout ce groupe d'indice fini contient un groupe de congruence, contient un groupe défini par des... Ce n'est pas tout à fait évident. Et ce que je voulais vous signaler aussi, c'est un exercice pour vous. Chevalet donne deux démonstrations. C'est à vous de trouver laquelle est correcte. Il n'y en a qu'une.
D'accord. Merci. Je pense qu'on peut remercier l'orateur.